Welcome back. In the earlier video, we started our discussion on Spark data frames. In this video, we will deep dive further and try to understand some internals of Apache Spark data frames. I am assuming that you have already watched the architecture video. We covered some RDD basics in that lesson. You might find that half of this video is reiterating the RDD concepts. And that happens because a data frame ultimately compiles down to an RDD. However, we will go ahead of those notions and also cover things that are specific to data frames. So, let's start. We already learned a method to load data frames from a source. What do you want to do next? If you have a business requirement, you might want to do some data processing and generate an output to meet your requirements. Let me give you a simple requirement. We already loaded mental health survey dataset. Can you generate following bar chart using that dataset? Well, we don't want to get into the visualization. So, let's reduce the requirement to an output dataset. The table here represents the final output that we want to achieve. I created the bar chart in MS Excel using the above table. Does it appear to be an easy requirement? Well, it is indeed an easy example. We are going to solve this problem. And while we develop a solution, you will also discover some important data frame concepts. We already learned that RDDs are immutable. Once loaded, you cannot modify them. However, you can perform following types of operations on RDDs: transformations and actions. Spark data frames carry the same legacy from RDDs. So, Spark data frames are also immutable. But you can perform transformations on them to generate new data frames. You can also perform actions on a Spark data frame, right? Let me take you to the documentation. I already explained that we need to look into dataset class. There is no Scala class for the data frame. The first set of methods are actions. Then we have some dataset functions. Let's leave these functions aside. Finally, you will see two categories of transformations: typed transformations and untyped transformations. Both of these are available to data frames. The typed transformation might return you a data set, but you can convert a data set to a data frame using the todf function. However, you don't need to worry too much about it because Spark can take care of that automatically. Transformations are the basic building blocks for Spark developers. They are the key tools for developers because we use transformations to express our business logic. Let's come back to our example. What do we want to do here? Let's look at the dataset. There is a field for treatment. This field records the response to the following question. Some people responded as yes and others as no. All we need to do is to count these yes and no's. Then group them by the gender. That's it. You will get the output table. Simple, isn't it? We can meet this requirement by applying a set of transformations. Let's try that. The first activity is to load the data into a data frame. There are many fields in this data set. However, for my requirement, I am only concerned with two fields: gender and treatment. So, let me apply a select transformation to select only two fields. The DF1 is a new data frame that contains only two fields. But I need to count yes and no's. So, I might need to separate them out into two different columns. Once I have all the yes in one column and all the no's in another column, I can easily count them. So, let's apply another transformation. This time, I am taking DF1 and applying another select transformation. I take the gender field as it was earlier. I am not applying any changes to this field. However, I am transforming the treatment field. When the treatment is yes, I take it as numeric 1. Otherwise, I take it as numeric 0. Now, I can simply take a sum of all yes columns to get the total number of yes, right? You might want to do it differently. For example, when the treatment is yes, take it as yes. Otherwise, take it as a null. Then you can apply a count function on that column. However, I prefer to take it as numeric value and apply the sum function instead of a count function. That helps me to avoid unnecessary dealing with nulls. You might also wonder that why do we apply two transformations for this? I mean, we could have done it in a single step. Let me show you. Instead of applying this transformation over df2, we could have applied it directly on df. I mean, we could have avoided the first transformation and completed it in a single step. You might argue that if we can avoid one transformation and do it as a single step, Spark might perform better, right? But that's not the truth in this case. There is no difference in performance, at least not in this example. Why? Let's try to understand that. We already learned in RDDs that the transformations are lazy. They don't execute until we fire an action. Spark implements data frames to be lazy because that design gives them at least two clear benefits. Spark engine can act as a compiler, and they get an opportunity to apply necessary optimizations. In our example, we applied two transformations. We haven't executed any action yet, so Spark has executed nothing yet on the cluster. You might see a load operation on Spark UI, but I am talking about those two select transformations. None of them are executed yet. Let's apply an action, df2.collect. Now we have one job here. If you jump to the SQL tab in the Spark UI and click on the collect job, you will get a lot of details. You will see four plans: parsed logical plan, analyzed logical plan, optimized logical plan, and finally the physical plan. When we execute an action, Spark takes the user code. In our case, it takes those two select transformations. It will then parse the user code and generate a parsed logical plan. For our example, the logical plan shows a relation here. That's our original data frame which we loaded from a CSV file, right? Then we have these two projections. These are our two select transformations. The first select simply takes two columns. The second select applies a case when then transformation. You should also notice that the column name gender is still unresolved. Spark is not yet sure about the existence and the data type of the column gender, and hence that column is marked as unresolved. The second step is to analyze the initial plan and resolve the column names and their data types. The output of the second step is an analyzed logical plan. Apache Spark maintains a catalog of all the tables and data frame information. The analyzer makes a call to the catalog and resolves the initial plan. The analyzed plan clearly shows the column names and data types, isn't it? Gender is a string. All yes and all no's, these two fields are of integer type. We still have two projections. The analyzed logical plan goes to an optimizer. As of now, the optimizer mainly performs two types of optimizations: pipelining and predicate pushdown. Pipelining is as simple as combining multiple transformations together. We created two transformations. Both were the select operations. Spark realizes that it can combine them together into a single transformation. So, it simply does that. You can cross-check it by looking at the optimized plan. Now we have a single projection. The pipelining optimization doesn't only apply to a select transformation. Spark will look for all such opportunities and apply the pipelining wherever it is applicable. The other type of optimization is the predicate pushdown. That simply means pushing down the filter conditions to the early stage instead of applying it at the end. We will see that happening in a minute. But for now, let's first close the parsing and compilation process. The optimized logical plan goes to the Spark compiler that generates a bunch of physical execution plans. The physical execution plan is nothing but a series of RDD transformations. The Spark engine generates multiple physical plans based on various considerations. Those considerations might be a different approach to perform a join operation. It may be a physical attribute of the underlying data file. It may be something else. However, Spark settles down to a single physical plan that it evaluates to be the best among others. Finally, the best plan goes to the execution on the cluster. Great. Let's come back to our example. We loaded data. We applied one transformation. Then we applied another transformation. But we haven't reached the desired output. I think if we group by the gender and compute a sum over the second and third column, we should get the desired output. Let's try that. Now we apply a group by on gender. Then aggregate to calculate the sum of the other two columns. All we are doing here is nothing but a simply chaining the data frame APIs. The syntax might look weird in the beginning, but you will be comfortable with this style in just few days. All the methods that I am using in this example are available in dataset documentation with some easy to follow examples. Let's check the output. Oops. It looks like gender field is not very well coded. We have a data quality problem. There are many ways to deal with this issue. You might want to use a tricky regular expression and translate each value to one of the genders, right? However, we have a small data set, and I think the safest method is to make a list of all unique values and handle them using a match case expression. I can quickly create a Scala function to handle it. Here is the code. Well, this is a plain Scala code, isn't it? We want this function to be available to all the executors. You can do that by registering this function as a UDF, user-defined function. Registering a UDF is as simple as passing the function to the UDF function. Spark will serialize the function on the driver and transfer it over the network to all executor processes. So, now we can use the parse gender UDF in our data frames. Let's create another transformation to fix our data quality problem. I'm using the data frame 2 and applying another select transformation. This time, we apply the parse gender UDF to the gender field. We also take all yes and all no's fields that we created earlier. Now we can do a group by on DF3. Great. Let's check the DF4. We got the desired output, right? We did this in several steps. You might have lost it somewhere in between, right? So let me show you all the steps at once. Start a Spark shell session. Load the dataset, select only two columns, transform the treatment column, create a Scala function, register it as a UDF, transform the gender, apply the aggregation, filter out the transgender, execute an action, right? I am applying a filter to show you the predicate pushdown optimization. Let's execute the complete code at once and jump to the Spark UI. Let me directly go to the SQL tab and check out the details for the collect action. You can see the DAG visualization. It is a nice representation of the physical plan, right? Let me take you to the optimized logical plan. You can see the relation at the bottom. This relation is the original data frame that we loaded from the CSV. The next operation is the filter condition. We applied the filter as the last operation, right? However, the optimizer realizes that the filter should be the first operation because it can eliminate the unnecessary data, and subsequent operation would need to deal with a smaller data set, right? Hence, the optimizer has pushed it down to the lowest level. The optimizer has also squeezed the plan. Now, we have a single projection. We executed three select operations, but the optimizer is smart enough to combine them into a single select operation. The final thing is the aggregate operation. The physical plan elaborates the aggregation into three steps. They perform the same group by and some aggregation at the partition level. Then they do a shuffle. The shuffle is primarily a repartitioning activity. In our example, the shuffle operation moves all the data for the male category in one partition and for the female category in another partition. Finally, they again perform an aggregation for both of the new partitions to arrive at the final result. That's it. That's what you see in DAG graph as well. If you do a further investigation, you might wonder to see a large number of tasks. I mean, why the hell do we have these 200 tasks? Let's try to understand that. Spark executed the collect job in two stages. And that's obvious. One stage before the shuffle and another stage after the shuffle, right? The first stage shows only one task. You can explain that easily. We had just one partition for our initial data frame and hence we see only one task, right? But what happened in the shuffle that the Spark created 200 tasks after the shuffle? We were looking for a count of the male and female categories. I was expecting that the shuffle will result in just two partitions. But why the hell it results in 200 partitions and 200 tasks? There is a Spark configuration parameter that sets the number of shuffle partitions. And the default value is 200. We can include the below statement in our code and try it again. This will set the shuffle partitions to 2 and we'll get only 2 partitions. Let me start a new session. Now we see just 2 tasks after the shuffle, right? Great. I covered a lot of things in this session. I talked about data frame transformations. We looked at the list of typed and untyped transformations. We also applied select, group by, and aggregate transformations, right? We created and used a Spark UDF. We also looked at various execution plans and the optimization. We learned all of this with the help of an extremely simple example. Great. That's all for now. I'll cover few more things on data frames in next session. Thank you for watching Learning Journal. Keep learning and keep growing.